Recently, the president made a revelation in his speech that telecommunication companies, rental income tax, and corporate taxes are causing a massive loss in the revenue for Uganda. According to the president, the real estate business is one of the fastest growing sectors in the country, yet rental income is severely undertaxed, causing a significant revenue loss for the government. He cited several factors that are contributing to this factor, including lack of insufficient knowledge for property owners about their obligations to pay taxes, inadequate urban planning, and lack of reliable data on the number of estates that are around in the country. All the above combined are causing a massive loss of revenue for the country. In the Homes and Construction series today, we look at rental taxes, what they are, and why are people taking long to pay them. My name is Hilda Kamkama, and without taking much of your time, let us dive into the show.
Tax-free threshold is 2,820,000. So if your gross annual rental income is below 2,820,000 and you are an individual, then you are not required to pay rental income tax. However, if your rental gross income exceeds 2,820,000, the rental income tax that you pay is at a rate of 12% on the difference between your gross rental income and the tax-free threshold of Uganda shillings 2,820,000. Now, for non-individuals, the companies, the retirement benefit schemes and the like, the formula is a little different.
How is it?
For non-individuals, we look at their gross rental income and then we allow them up to 50% of that gross rental income to cater for expenses that have been incurred in generating this income. And then the difference of 50% is taxed at a rate of 30%.
30% of the 50?
Of the 50%.
Don't you think it is kind of like unfair? Because we've had landlords at times when they're complaining, tenants don't pay, tenants run out of their buildings. And yeah, as you are, you are estimating that everyone, like every tenant, pays their rent on time.
Yeah, now, the effects of premises being vacant are taken care of in arriving at what I called the gross rental income. If I can give an example, if you can allow me to give a computational example of, let's say, someone who has rental units in Banda. They have 5 units, and from each unit, they charge rent of 500,000 per month. So if these units are fully occupied throughout the 12 months period, it means that every month, they're generating 2.5 million from the 5 units. And in a year, they'll have generated 2.5 times 12, which is 30 million. Okay,
yeah,
that's 30 million. So that's the gross rental income. But there are instances where some of the units are not occupied during that 12 months period. Now that will be taken into account in arriving at the gross rental income. So if, for instance, one of the units was occupied for only 6 months, we will get the 500,000 times 12 for the 4 units. And then for this 5th unit that was occupied for only 6 months, the gross rental income from it will be the 500,000 times only 6 months. So you'll find that the gross rental income for a landlord whose units are not fully occupied will be lower.
Now, how do you get to know about that information? Is the landlord on shares, or you have a team actually on ground to check every month to know this is occupied, this is not occupied?
The system of payment of taxes that we run is what we call a self-declaration system or a self-declaration regime. So the landlord is expected to make these declarations themselves at the end of the year, clearly indicating the rental income that they have earned or generated during that year of income. Okay? If you remember in one of our initiatives, I talked about compliance reviews, checking the declaration that a taxpayer has made. We know that sometimes these declarations are made dishonestly. So that's where we go and do field inspections to verify some of these facts. And then sometimes we use data from our third-party partners to establish occupancy and the rates that were paid during the year. But in essence, it is the landlord that is supposed to honestly make these declarations and indicate clearly how much they earned. And for companies, an allowance of 50% of what they actually earned is given to them, and then a tax of 30% applied on the difference of 50%.
Now, just for a layman that is out there and does not know how to do this, how can a landlord genuinely declare what they earn from their property? Please,
the starting point, viewers and landlords out there, is by registering for taxes with the Uganda Revenue Authority. To be registered for taxes means you obtain what we call a tax identification number, commonly known as a TIN number. So if you are a landlord, you have a TIN number with a clear indication that your source of income is rent or income. The next step after registration is filing of the return, where you're supposed to go to our URL web portal and then enter the details of the income that you earned. Fortunately, this declaration form has been simplified. It's now web-based, and the computations of tax are automatically done for you. So as a landlord, particularly the individuals, all you need to do is have your exercise book maybe somewhere where you indicate how much you're earning on a monthly basis, which eventually will be translated into annual. Then you make the declaration of your gross annual rental income, and then the tax-free threshold of 2820 will be reduced. It's automatically computed in the web-based form that is provided on the URL web portal, and the applicable tax of 12% is also automatically applied. So as you submit, there will be a clear indication of the tax that has been generated from the gross rental income that you have declared in a web-based form.
Because we've seen also other people having their rentals as a side business when they're earning other, when they may be employed in other offices, but they have a team. So how does that work? They get every source of income that they generate from different avenues declared to your end?
A very good question. I have seen confusion, yes. Our dear clients sometimes think that if you have different sources of income, you're supposed to have maybe more than one TIN. I have seen people who are formerly employed who get TINs for that purpose, and then maybe later through their savings they build some rentals, and then they begin to believe that maybe they're supposed to get another TIN. Friends, a TIN is a unique identifier for a taxpayer, and it is issued once. So no single taxpayer should have more than one TIN. The difference here is that if you're earning, let's say, employment income, if you're formerly employed like myself, and then you also have rentals, there will just be an indication on your TIN that you are an employee of URA, you're an employee of Vision Group, but you also have another source of income, which is rental. Now, the obligations for these different sources of income differ. If you're an employee, the tax as an employee is paid through what we call the pay as you earn. You know, those 30% that are deducted at source by your employer. So as an employee, you have no further obligation on that. However, if you have rental as well, in addition to your employment income, the obligation that I shared earlier in terms of filing of the return and payment of the resultant tax squarely lies with you.
In an event where I fail to comply, not because I have refused, but because I don't know, what happens?
Non-compliance is very costly. I must very clearly state this. It is very costly. Compliance is at three major levels. The first is registration to obtain what we call a taxpayer identification number. The second is in filing of your returns. Then the third is in making payment. In there is another obligation of making honest and accurate declarations. But principally, those are the obligations. And when you do not comply with any one of these obligations, there are consequences. I'll start with failing to comply with the obligation to file a return. Hilda, if you can allow me to quickly share with our viewers the statutory timelines within which, now, for individuals, we run a 12-month period that we call a financial year.
Sure.
And like I mentioned, rental income tax is charged on an annual basis. Now, when a financial year begins, and the normal financial year runs from July of 1 year to June of another year. Now, the current financial year started on 1st of July, 2022, and it's going to run up to 30th of June, 2023. So we can use this as the reference financial year for purposes of clearly understanding the timelines and the obligations that fall when. In this financial year for individuals, you have an obligation to file what we call a provisional return.
Provisional return. What is that?
Now, a provisional return is where the taxpayer makes a declaration of their estimated income for the 12 months period.
What exact time is that supposed to happen?
Now, interesting. For individuals, you are expected to file your provisional return within the first 3 months of the financial year.
That's July, August.
Exactly. So if we are taking
September,
this financial year as a reference financial year, the first 3 months of this financial year were July 2022, August 2022, and September 2022. So by 30th of September 2022, every individual who earns rental income is expected to make a declaration through a return of their estimated rental income for the 12 months.
Where do they get that information from?
It's an estimate. We all know that, for example, if you have your 5 Uzigos, you have tenants in them, and you have a bit of historical information, you have a bit of an estimate of how much will be paid over that 12 months period. So you make that declaration within the first 3 months. However, you have an opportunity to continuously amend it as the financial year progresses.
Okay.
So where you are found on the wrong side of the law is if you don't make the estimate within the first 3 months. Okay? So now, once you make the estimate as an individual, there's a resultant tax, which represents tax on estimated income for the 12 months period. You have an obligation to make payment of that tax in 4 equal quarterly installments.
Okay.
So the first quarter of that will be due by the 30th of September, when the return is also due. Then the second quarter will be due by 31st of December. The third quarter will be due by 31st of March. And then the fourth and final quarter will be due by 30th of June. So you have met your obligation to file a provisional return and also make payment of the resultant quarterly payments of the resultant tax. Now, when the financial year ends, you now have actual results. You now know exactly how much you generated over that 12 months period.
The other one was an estimate.
Now this is the actual.
So that's the time for filing.
For now, filing what we call now the final return. Now, for the final return, we give you 6 months from the end of the financial year.
Which is
in reference to this financial year. That would be July 2023 mm-hmm. up to 31st December 2023. So now you file the final return. You're now giving us actual details of the rental income that you earned during that financial year that ended. Tax will be computed on the actual income. Now, whatever resultant tax that arises mm-hmm. will be reduced by the provisional tax that you paid in the quarterly installments over the course of the financial year.
So does that mean that someone from Tungamo has to make their way to URA offices each and every time when they're maybe going to file for their provisional return or filing for return, returns? Wow.
Absolutely not. We, as URA, have made significant strides in the direction of making compliance for the taxpayer as easy as possible,
as
seamless and as enriching an experience as it can be.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these returns can be filed in the comfort of the living room because they are web-based returns.
The web?
Web-based returns means you go to the URA web portal. Even if you're outside of Uganda, you could be on the beach having a good time as long as you have a computer and access to internet, which thankfully is almost everywhere these days. You're able to log into your URA portal account and file your return. It takes about 5 to 10 minutes for the rental income tax return. Very easy, very simple, very convenient.
Don't you think that limits people who actually are not learned? Let me say, if I'm terming like that, people who are not really conversant with the web, people, because I believe on the web it's English.
Oh yes.
But we have people who don't know English, who don't understand English. So how do you cater for that sector of people?
Hilda, what we've done is, in addition to our online service platforms, we also have URA touch points spread across the country.
Mm-hmm.
Over 40 URA touch points. Yeah. So where a taxpayer is not able to do this on their own,
mm-hmm.
they have the opportunity to walk to the nearest URA office with their details, and then they will be supported to file their return and to make payment of the resultant tax.
Walking to the offices, URA offices, let me say, like, have you been to, okay, those days when someone would walk to like Kawumeme offices, you make a line from morning up to lunch, then they are breaking off for lunch, then they come back. Maybe when it clocks 5, they're like, we're sorry, we are stopping here. Maybe come back tomorrow early. So don't you think that's also a little bit inconvenient?
Yes, it is, but we have other options. Like I said, we have our Tujenge bus.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what our Tujenge bus does is, it's a bus that has fully fledged office facilities. And it's a mobile bus that moves to places where we don't have offices
mm-hmm.
and then offers on the site, on the go tax services, including supporting our taxpayers who are in far too rich places
mm-hmm.
to comply with their obligations of filing returns and making payment of the resultant
mm-hmm.
tax. So we believe that with all these options, depending on what is convenient for you,
mm-hmm.
if you're able to go online, so be it. If you're able to walk to a URA office, so be it. And these days we have especially on the peak days
mm.
where taxpayers are expected to file.
Which
returns.
Ones are those? Like
end of month
mm.
for the monthly returns away from rental by the 15th.
Mm.
We have staff that work extended hours mm. and also provide support over the weekend. We also have our URA call center, which works almost 24/7.
Mm.
So anyone could reach out and they could give you a step-by-step guide on how you can comply.
Mm.
So Hilda and our dear taxpayers, we believe that with this variety of channels, compliance should be a much easier task, because we are committed as URA to walk this compliance journey with our taxpayers.
Now that brings me to mind the next question. How best have you done your sensitization to the taxpayers, especially in this regard of the rental income tax?
Hilda and viewers, one of the things that we have purposed to do is to come up with what we call sector-based and tailored sensitization programs. We observe that a one-size-fit-all approach is not very effective. So we have developed sensitization programs that target specific sectors, that target specific groups of our taxpayers. Now, coming back to rental, rental is a tax from, you know, the bigger real estate sector. So even within real estate sector, we have come up with sensitization programs for landlords who rent out their premises or their property for rental income. We come up with programs that target, for example, dealers in land. You know, real estate includes some taxpayers who buy big chunks of land, cut those big chunks into small parcels and sell those. We know that the challenges and the pains of those ones are unique to the pains that the typical landlord experiences. So we carry out these tailor-made sensitization programs so that we specifically tackle the pains of a particular subsector or a particular group of taxpayers. But we also do this in collaboration with a critical stakeholder that we believe have significant influence over our targeted audience. We have in the real estate sector, we have associations. I'll talk about Kampala. We have the Fatherland Group. We have the Real Estate Owners Association. We have Kampala Arcade Owners Association. Then we have the local council one chairperson, like I mentioned earlier. So we collaborate a lot with these critical stakeholders, one, to get their buy-in and support, but also to make inroads in what sometimes would be difficult taxpayers to reach on our own. But we also collaborate a lot with other government agencies to avoid what sometimes might come off as fatigue to the client. Because the CEO goes, then URA also comes, then URSP also comes. So we have programs and collaborative frameworks that provide for joint operations in the field, joint sensitizations, but also the whole idea of making it easy for the taxpayer to do their business. Still talking sensitizations, of course, we have this as a classic example of our talk shows and the discussions that we hold with different TV and radio stations. We have the tax footage, the reach out program through the Pijenge that I talked about. Very important is our translation of tax literature into the local languages. Yes, so that it's easy for even
to cater for.
Absolutely. But I want us to note that we've come up with a program where we want to inculcate a taxpaying culture through the young generations. So we've gone to schools, we've gone to universities and set up tax associations and tax clubs so that the future generation is a tax-aware generation.
Apparently, students don't pay a lot of tax, right?
Absolutely.
But you're just preparing them for what is coming ahead.
Absolutely. Yes.
Now, having said everything that we've just gone through, why is it becoming a problem, or why is it challenging for people to take on their tax obligations?
I think one of the issues that we have observed is the literacy levels. Yes. Truthfully, we know that we have very many taxpayers out there who are naturally gifted business people. They've made their money, but they've not really gone far with their education. So it's a bit of a hindrance, which, like I mentioned, we are making an attempt to overcome through our sensitization programs. Yes, sensitization. With all this attempt, I still believe that there is more that we can do, because today I am sure that there could be a viewer out there who is hearing this message for the first time. Yeah. So we have done a lot in the space of sensitization, but we believe that there is more that we can still do to reach out to almost every taxpayer. It's like the gospel, which has been around for thousands of years.
Taxation plays a crucial role in driving the processes of our nation. That's why it needs our utmost attention and effort in paying our taxes promptly. In our inaugural series today, we delved into an enlightening conversation with the manager rental taxes at URA, where we looked at who are the people that are supposed to pay the rental income tax, what are the percentages and the timelines for paying these taxes. And in our next episode, we are going to be looking at the repercussions of someone who has defaulted, who has failed to file their returns or pay their taxes on time. My name is Hilda Kamkama, and this has been the Homes and Construction Show. Have a pleasant day, and don't even change your dial.